What's up, guys? It's your boy Damone, and welcome back to another Epic 7 video. So hype! We finally got part two of the dev notes for the 614 June developer notes. This is the second part that they were mentioning before. So we're going to talk about these today, break this down, and give my take as to what's getting ready to happen. So without further ado, guys, let's go ahead and dive on in. They said this is super creative. Today, we'll be sharing with you the Epic 7 Festa FAQ. We here at Epic 7 feel that the most entertaining aspect of Epic 7 comes when players can improve their hero. In order to improve this aspect of Epic 7, we have gradually tried to improve areas that have impeded hero growth, such as a supply versus demand of equipment, as well as items necessary for enhancing hero skill. With the updates that will occur in June, we are improving the supply of accessory. After the updates in June, we plan to monitor how these changes affect the community, basically pay attention to stats. And additionally, we plan on continually improving Epic 7 with updates, and we apologize that we weren't able to deliver these answers at the Epic 7 Festa. All right, guys. Number one, Molagora improvements. I know a lot of you guys talk about this. I know they've made it a lot easier to get molas, but I guess they're going to adjust it again. They said in a previous update on March 28th, the second improvement to the Molagora system was implemented. However, because it appears that all skills that some players wish to enhance for their various heroes are still too costly, We are preparing a third round of improvements to the Molagora system. Currently, we are planning on reducing the Molagora cost to be 12 to 18% lower than the current standard and are preparing to implement these changes in the July update. After the Molagora system is improved, players will receive any excess Molagora spent via their in-game mailbox. In addition to these changes, we have also created new content which rewards players with Molagora 2. Awesome. For example, we have added the Adventurous Path missions, which rewards players Molagora necessary for early hero progression, and starting on July 1st, the new content Automaton Tower will also offer Molagora as reward. However, please know that we are not considering a skill recall function, unfortunately. We are planning new content so that different heroes can be used in a variety of content, such as for World Boss, which will be included in the future. Additionally, we will continue to balance heroes so that every hero can be used effectively. They said every hero. Alright, so for those of you guys who weren't here when they did the Molagora thing, basically back in the day, there were three tiers of Molagoras, right? So right now you guys see the Molagora Go, and then after the Molagora Go, there was like a Molagora Go-Go, or I can't remember what it's called, but you basically had to turn the Molagora Goes into the third tier, right? It was such a pain. So they nerfed that, they took the third out, and then lowered the amount, and it was cool. Now they're gonna lower it again. Well, they recently lowered it again, and gave us excess Molagora. I had like 47 Molagora after that, or 50 Molagora. It's crazy. But now, if they're lowering it again by another 12 to 18%, it's looking like it's only gonna be one Molagora Go per max skill in each slot, minus however many multiples they gave. So it's cool, man. I'm glad that they're continuing to tweak this, because this is awesome, and this is gonna make it easier for players to build heroes, because over time, like, especially at the rate that they come out with new heroes, the Molagora and the access to the Molagora definitely needs to be improved. So I can absolutely appreciate this. So I hope you guys are excited about this as I am, because this means and I'm about to probably buy the Molagora pack. Let's go. But anyway, guys, next up, we're talking about the balance changes. Recently, we have received many questions regarding the balancing of new Moonlight heroes, and we consider these questions very important. Moonlight heroes have been designed particularly for PvP content. Currently, we do not offer any PvE endgame content that allows players to compete with each other, so heroes that are commonly used in PvP content have a higher value. Later on, we plan on revamping quests and introducing new and more challenging PvE content, such as World Boss, so that other heroes can be used in additional content and become more valuable. In addition to these changes, we will also be monitoring the usage of newly released heroes and balancing older heroes so that the rate of selection isn't drastically different when compared to newly released heroes. Additionally, we plan on creating new metas and strategies with the release of new heroes. At the Epic Festa, we announced balance changes that would occur on the 27th. We will go into the finer details of these changes in a separate notice. First, though, we would like to explain the main intention of the balance changes within this notice. All right, so there's a new hero coming up, guys. New hero Lilibet is planned to be released as a warrior with an ability called Extinction. Extinction is a powerful new skill set that disables the target hero from being able to use Revive both passively and actively. Let's go! I hate Ruelle, man. I hate her. Currently, heroes that can employ resurrection effects are heavily used in arena, and with the addition of health sets, it is not easy to effectively counter these heroes. The new hero Lilibet aims to add new strategies into the arena, both on offense and defense, allowing for new party configurations and a wider and healthier meta. Thank you. Oh, tell you, listen, guys, there is nothing that feels better in life than killing Ruelle.
Nothing.
So next up, Arbiter of Vildred. Revival is a key component for Arbiter of Vildred. However, after revival, some players found it difficult to deal damage and to continue to survive. Thank God. Please do something about this guy. Various improvements have been made to increase the effectiveness of Arbiter of Vildred. Please see the balance changes for Arbiter of Vildred. All right, here we go. Let's go. Okay, so sweep, his first one. Damage dealt no longer affected by health loss. Instead, the base value of the damage dealt will increase by 30%. Let's go. Yeah. Oh, dude, listen, man. This dude, it didn't matter what gear, like literally my Arbiter of Vildred, he's like almost max skilled. He's like his third is max. I haven't touched his two yet. I started working on his first, and I would put crazy gear on this dude, and he would still hit like he was Angelica or something. Like, it was ridiculous. So that 30% damage increase is gonna be nice. So Dark Contract is skill 2. After this passive is activated, his combat readiness gauge will increase to 100%, and his he just became the best hero in the game. Oh, his combat readiness gauge will increase to 100%, and his attack will increase for 2 turns. Passive cooldown, 10 turns to 5 turns. Oh my god, bro, that's OP. Hello, Perna from Summoner's War, let's go. And his third skill, Dark Blade, damage dealt will no longer be affected by health loss. Instead, the base value of the damage dealt will increase to 30% by 30%. And decrease hit chance will be increased to 100%. So for those of you guys who aren't familiar with Arbiter of Vildred, you don't have one. Arbiter of Vildred was one of the first MO5s I pulled. And it basically takes him from a 0.8 multiplier to a 1.2 or 1.1 to 1.2 on his first skill. And on his third skill from a 0.9, I think, to 1.2 or maybe even 1.3. So it's a big, big difference. And the decreased hit chance will be increased to 100%. Let's go. I'm hyped about that passive because now he's an anti-cleave. Like, you put him in an arena team and he dies, he comes back 100% combat readiness increase. And it's like, well, bam, bro. Well, bam. We don't care about that full life regen. Let's go. Let's go. Listen, the way that his third skill works overall is if he kills somebody with his third skill, it doesn't go on cooldown. So now he could pop that third skill, and if he dies after he uses the third skill and he goes out, then yo, let's go. My man Arbiter. All right, man, I forgive you. I forgive you. So please see below for an explanation of Arbiter Vildred's skills. So self-resurrection, combat readiness, and attack improvements. When the improved Arbiter Vildred resurrects through his passive skill, Dark Contract, he grants himself 100% combat readiness and increased attack. In most situations, immediate action is possible after resurrection, and with an increased attack, powerful attacks can be made with the skill Dark Blade. Now, an improvement to Arbiter Vildred's passive skill Dark Contract allows for him to attack right after self-revival due to his combat readiness gauge being increased to 100%. The increase in combat readiness and attack following revival allows Arbiter to use Dark Blade to great effect. Now, damage increase and performance enhancement. Currently, the more life that Arbiter Vildred loses, the stronger his attacks become, which is stupid, right? Because we have decided to remove this requirement and instead increase his base attack so that players can consistently expect high performance from him. Additionally, we have also increased the decreased hit chance from 70 to 100% when Dark Blade is used. To summarize, Arbiter Vildred not only offers powerful resurrection abilities, but also an increase to attack power. In addition, the reduction of Dark Contract's cooldown to 5 turns allows the improved Arbiter Vildred to show his true power. Let's go! Listen, I'm so hyped for this. You guys, listen, I've been dragging my Arbiter Vildred's feet through the dirt for a long time, y'all. Long time. Like, I cannot stress this. And I've wanted him to be good. I've molded him. I've played with him. I tested different builds, different everything. Like, I tried everywhere to try to make this guy work, and it was like, nada. And it's crazy because we were talking about this on stream, and I was like, yo, if they made his revive to where he got a turn instantly, that would change the entire frame of his abilities. And that's exactly what they did, bro. Let's go. Let's go. So, anyway, Ravi's about to get a... Oh, just pulled Ravi. Let's go. Oh, like, today's a good day, y'all. So Ravi is a tanking dealer with the ability to absorb damage as health. There are advantages and disadvantages when using her skill, Devil Drive. Utilizing her skill may not always go over smoothly. Yeah, because it takes so damn long to use. We plan to rebalance Ravi so that more favorable situations can be created when she deals and life steals. So please see below for the rebalancing changes made to Ravi. So slaughter, amount of fighting spirit obtained has increased from 10 to 30. Wow. Okay. That's a big deal, all right? So double drive before damage dealt increases proportional to fighting spirit, and now after damage dealt increases proportional to attacks and damage taken. Wow.
Wow.
So the conditions for attack increase have been adjusted. We have made improvements to the initialization of attack increase when the skill Devil Drive is used. The rebalanced Ravi is independent of the fighting spirit, and her attack increase effect persists when she attacks or even when she takes damage. Okay, so the amount of fighting spirit after using the skill Slaughter has increased. So for the skill Slaughter, we have significantly increased the amount of fighting spirit granted from 10 to 30. This means that Ravi will be able to use her skill Devil Drive more frequently, which is good, which will allow her to stun the enemy more often and utilize her lifesteal effect. So to summarize, Ravi is different from other typical warriors because she can attack and tank at the same time, which is very true. We have enhanced the hero and improved the usability of the skill, which gives enemies powerful debuffs. We intended to have a hero who can greatly contribute when attacking the enemy and bring about stability to the team. Basically, what happened before was Ravi had to take damage, and every time she was attacked, she would gain a certain amount of fighting spirit. Now, the amount that she gained was pretty much laughable, especially since with an unskilled Ravi, you needed 80 fighting spirit if you didn't have a Molagora for her to use her skill 3. So you guys know, for her to get attacked, the amount of times for her to max out and use skill 3 was stupid because she would never get a turn. Now, if you position her as a tank, which I'm building mine as, she has to get hit less times so she can use her skill 3 more frequently. And based on that, now she can use that AoE stun with 100% combat readiness reduction a lot faster, which is a really, really good change to Ravi, because now I feel like she's actually going to have an impact in combat. So this is going to be good. This is going to have to see. Again, she's going to have to get hit 3 times. Well, 2.5 times-ish. Because if you have her max skilled, then it's only 70 fighting spirit required. So we're going to have to see how this pans out. This is going to take some testing. And of course, we'll play with this post-patch. So Cigarette, I pulled three Cigarettes, y'all. 3 of them. She's like literally was like one of the... She was my first hero I started the game with when I did my resets. Cigarette is who I started with. I started Cigarette and Dominio, and I've pulled 2 more Cigarettes since then. Okay, so previously Cigarette was one seen as the damage dealer who could attack consecutively. However, relative to other heroes, she's not as prominent as she once was. You're right, because, like, who uses Cigarette? Nobody. In order to make Cigarette more viable as a damage dealer, we have made the following improvements. Full specs will be listed in detail later on, and the table below is a tentative version of her changes. So Sever, the chance of inflicting 2 bleed effects is increasing from 35 to 50%. Okay. Smash, chance of inflicting bleeding is increase from 85% to 100%, and Guillotine penetrates defense by 30%. So, I mean, it still kind of sounds the same. In addition to the heroes mentioned, we are also considering changes to the following heroes. Judge Kisei, let's go! Let's go! Man, this is the best balance patch ever! Maid Chloe, so for these guys complaining about Maid Chloe, there you go. Violet is about to get buffed. Bloodblade Karin, okay. Assassin Cid, yes. Okay, regular Corvus, regular Cartuya, Purgis, regular Purgis, and Lots. I'd imagine they're probably going to increase Purgis's counterattack. And if they do that, yo, Purgis is about to be annoying, bruh. We look forward to hearing the valuable opinions of our heirs in regards to these heroes that have been selected. Please note that these changes above are not final. They may differ when the actual balance update occurs. Epic 7 would like to be able to balance heroes and artifacts approximately every 6 to 8 week intervals to encourage unique metas with players using a wider variety of heroes. Yo, this is a dope. Like, I have Cigarette. I got Ravi. I got Arbiter. I got Judge. Like, I'm like, let's go, man. Just buff all my heroes. All right. So next time, Moonlight Summon improvements. So the amount of materials required in order for players to be able to receive a Moonlight Summon is high. Additionally, the difference between expected results and the actual results is also large. Therefore, we have been discussing the need to implement certain safety measures. However, we need to take caution as we approach this issue because making improvements to the summon system would change the value of many heroes and material in the game. We've heard a lot of opinions from our ears regarding this issue, and both developers and publisher regard it as a important issue. I don't know what that even means. I don't know if that means they're going to do like a selective Moonlight Summon, or maybe they'll just lower the amount. Maybe they'll lower from 6 to 5. Because that would be nice. Like, y'all should just lower the amount of transmit stones that it takes. Because you would effectively give us like a $50 discount on Moonlights. So I think that would just be nice. Just lower the amount of transmit stone. That's all you gotta do. That's it. And it's done. So gameplay convenience improvements. Next, we will take a look at the improvements that will be made to ensure that our players have a more comfortable gameplay experience. These details are the same as what was discussed during the Epic 7 Festa Q&A. However, a lot of our heirs did not know about these details due to the fact that they were not added to the previous developer's notes. We would like to share them with you now. 10 consecutive summons. In the beginning of the update, we did not consider adding a feature where users would be able to carry out 10 consecutive summons. However, we are now looking into the possibility of this feature. Even if we introduce this feature later on, we think that it is more important to improve the current one-time summon system first. In this previous update, we made adjustments so that players do not have to click tap, but that was the fun part. Current improvements include adding an option to skip certain steps when summoning and improving the process for when players are summoning repeatedly. Repeat battle and auto open treasure chests. So we are currently preparing a pet system which will improve gameplay during battle. We are not just thinking about adding pets that would only have a single function, but we would like players to acquire pets that they will nurture and strengthen, pets that will help them on their adventures in Orbis, bruh. Raising pets, bro. Let's go. Due to all these factors, it seems that the development of this feature is getting delayed. However, we do plan to add this feature during the third quarter at the earliest, or sometime within the year at the latest. It's something that they're working on. Don't get your hopes up this year. If it comes this year, great. If it doesn't, oh well, it'll be here next year. Auto promote system. We, the development team, think that the process when promoting the hero is quite complicated and is vital to improve the process. The following are the steps that are taken when promoting a hero. Select a hero to promote from the hero list, tap the promote button. Select heroes will be used as promotional material, tap on the promote button. A long effect animation is played, a pop-up displaying the enhanced stance is displayed. Exit the promotion window, select another hero to promote. We are going to make improvements that will ease this process, at least for Phantasma. We plan to make these improvements in July at the earliest. So I think, like, summarizing this, I think it would be really cool if I can go on my phone, click a Phantasma, hit promote, and it automatically takes like 2 level 1 2-stars, right? And just does that. Now, I think this can get tricky though if you start trying to promote 3-star Phantasmas and 4-star Phantasmas, so it's kind of tough, but I'm curious to see what they have planned. I'm sure like their QA team is probably testing all this, but I'm excited to see what they're going to do. Inventory expansion is the last thing we're going to hit up today. There are many details that are involved for us to make adjustments of the hero window and expand the inventory. As a result, it's not possible to make changes immediately, right? Because they got to change everything. However, we understand the frustration that players face due to the lack of space in their inventory. We have worked on and are still working on the following to fix this issue. So a storage feature added in the 529 update, right? So when you're summoning, right? Charms, excluding equipment charms, will be sent to another inventory in order to free up more space. Once the plans have been completed, we will look into carrying out additional changes. So listen, guys, all y'all gotta do is make it so our equipment that we have equipped doesn't count towards our overall inventory. That's it. Just make the standard inventory outside of what we have currently equipped on our characters, and we're good, man. And maybe add a storage system, and we're Gucci. That's it. It's that simple. Occam's razor. Simplest solution, best solution. All right. So anyway, guys, short dev notes, but powerful, potent, crazy dev notes, especially if you guys have these heroes. So what I'd recommend is if you guys have these heroes or you guys are preparing for Lilibet, and I'm curious about Lilibet too, because if Lilibet blocks revival, she's going to be Arbiter Vildred's nemesis, which is good because I got Arbiter on immunity, so we'll be all right. But that's something that we're going to have to look at. We got to see if Lilibet is going to be like a passive skill, an active skill, if it's a debuff or whatever. We're going to have to see how that plays out with Lilibet. And then, of course, make sure you guys, if you have Ravi and your Ravi been sitting on the burner, I don't know how I feel about Cigarette just yet, just because, like, yeah, the increased chance to bleed and stuff is cool and all, but, you know, I don't know. We'll see. We'll see exactly what the full details are, but I'm curious to see what the Judge Kisei buff is going to be. May, Chloe, Violet, Bloodblade, Karn, Assassin, Cid, Corvus, Cartuja, Purgis, and Lots. I'm really, really curious to see how these heroes are going to be affected. So, this is a crazy deal. I literally just 6-star Bloodblade, Karn, like, 2 days ago. So, I'm like, let's go. 27, let's go. But anyway, guys, let me know what you guys think about these changes. What do you think they're going to do about the Moonlight Summon? And what are you most excited about this patch, you know, about these dev notes? Let me know in the comment box below. I'll make sure I post the link here. Matter of fact, let me copy that right now. And if you guys have any other questions, comments, concerns, definitely let me know in the comment box below. And we will see you guys in the next video. Peace.